Okay. To turn to Second Kings 5:1, just wanted to say, this is Second Kings 5:1. Last week we were mentioning about there are certain things about us, certain virtues about us that really helps, that enables God to do a whole lot of things for us. I guess everybody's just praying that God will multiply the blessings and expand our horizons and help us to tap in on all of the great abundance and blessings that He has. I just want to kind of take some time and just look at the characters of what the Bible says about some people that place themselves in a position where God can do a whole lot of things for them. Last week we talked about Naaman and this lady, the widow of Zarah. If you will look at, there are some of the virtues you can see very clearly why God was able to do such super abundance for them. I want to start with Naaman first, because last week we started with the widow of Zarephath and how God, through Elijah, multiplied the cup of meal that was remaining. That was the only food she had in the house, was just a cup of meal and a cruise of oil. About to eat that and die, her and her son. But the prophet showed up, the prophet was sent from God, and God had already commanded the talk to the prophet about a woman would be found in Zarephath that would be very, very poor at the point of death, only having a cup of meal in a house and a cruse of oil. God told Elijah to go to this woman's house, and she would be able to take care of him and feed him for a year. Amen. That was a miracle, wasn't it? Amen. But the woman, I'm sure she had some fear, but God had already dealt with her. She had heard from God, and even sometimes hearing from God, you still have fear, right? Sometimes you know what the word says, sometimes you still be scared, right? Sometimes you still be scared to what step out of the word of God. Sometimes sense knowledge is very difficult to overcome. Amen. You just can't walk by sense knowledge. You have to walk by what? Maybe that's what God said. Sometimes what God said doesn't seem like it's going to what? Pan out. So in that case, you still have to step out anyway, right? Step out anyway, but you have to know it's God, right? Mm-hmm. Amen. There you go. Know when you can know whether it's God or not? It's not guesswork, is it? It's not guesswork. But anyway, she had courage to step out, and she made the cake first and gave it to him. The prophet, just like he had commanded her, and because she obeyed the prophet and disregarded her senses, the Bible says, if we observe blind vanities, we forsake God's mercy. If we observe blind vanities. In other words, blind vanities, when it seems like God tell you to do something, and it seems like what? It's not, if that can't work. You know, I don't see how in the world, how this can work. But if we disregard the word of God and be influenced more by our five senses and what our flesh is dictating, then we're not going to be able to take the advantage of God's mercies. The Bible says we forsake our own deliverance. We forsake the mercies of God. We turn turn our back on the mercies of God, when we respond to what our flesh is saying rather than what the Word of God is saying. How can you tell whether it's God or whether it's the flesh? Well, if it's God, it's always consistent with what?
That
Word. Is that right?
Amen.
Amen. Word is your best guide. Amen. So the Word says if you do this and your flesh said you can't do it this time, it's not going to work. Amen. You got to have some sense. You got to use your five senses. Okay, many times we are inclined to what? To let our flesh rule us. And when we do that, the Bible says we forsake our own mercy. So this is the reason why many times the mercies of God can't reach us, because we forsake them. That means that we give in to what? Lying vanities. Amen. Praise God. So be on guard against those lying vanities, because every day you're going to have to contend with what? Lying vanities. Okay, but it wasn't a whole lot written by this lady. The Bible says that when she obeyed the man of God, Elijah showed up and said, if you give me that first piece of cake made from that last cup of meal that you have, that last cruise of oil, if you give me my portion first, then you won't have to worry about the remaining year in which no food will be found in the land. The meal barrel will not what? Will not be depleted, neither will your cruise of oil fail. All right, so it happened. Bible said, she ate, the son ate, the prophet ate. Whole year, the meal never went down. Amen. Boy, I like to see even that miracle. That meal, I don't care how much they cook from it, it never went down. It just went down, let's say it went down a quart. Amen. After it went down a quart, what? It just come on back up a quart. Amen. Y'all heard the miracle about Elijah, he multiplied, Elisha multiplied the oil, right? Commanded this widow that her sons were about to be sold for a debt that she owed, and he worked that miracle, and he commanded her to go everywhere she could find a vessel, and she went and borrowed a vessel, got every vessel in the house, and when she couldn't borrow no more vessels, he said, close the door. The Bible said that when he talked to God, that miracle of oil began to flow. Oil began to flow in all of those vessels. And when it got down to the last vessel, she couldn't find no more, then it stopped. Then she had enough from selling oil to pay the back debt that she owed to her creditors. And that was the thing that helped her to receive her deliverance. How many believe that God is still a miracle worker? Amen. So the average person would say, I don't mean no harm. That's what I read. I don't mean no harm. But I don't see how you can fill all these vessels here when there's no oil in the room to fill it with. I think he had one little thing of oil, so he just started pouring the one off, and then the oil never stopped. That one little pot of oil, get all those vessels that she got from all around, he filled them all up. And when she couldn't produce no more vessels, then the oil ceased to flow. Okay, now what was it about this lady? She doesn't have a whole lot of good things, a lot of powerful things. See, Naaman in the fifth chapter, he was a captain of the host of the king of Syria. He was a great man with his master and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance into Syria. He was also a mighty man in battle, but he was a leper. So this woman that we're speaking about now, that was 1 Kings, what, 17? It doesn't say anything about her, but just call her a widow of Zara. She was just a plain, ordinary woman whose heart was open to what God was saying to her. I don't see anything that she was honorable, famous, powerful. She was a great woman of valor or anything. I don't see anything about that. But one thing about this little woman, she had childlike faith. She just took God at his word. I believe that the Bible says God has chosen the poor of this world, rich in faith, to be heirs of the kingdom. He's chosen the poor. Amen. Faith is one of the greatest virtues that we can have as the people of God. Just take God at his word. Just take God at his word. God allow you? Can he be depended on?
Yes, amen.
But how many can depend on anybody you know? You depend on too many folks, right? There are some people we can depend on. Amen. We got some people that we can what? Depend on. Amen. But God is not a man that he should what?
Lie.
God said it, amen, it's always going to be what? It's always going to be according to the word of God. Amen. So that woman, God had quickened her heart, spoken to her, and she received the word, and she just took him at his word. You know, he told her, fear not. He admonished her, don't fear, don't let your past senses get up a hand on you. Don't regard lying vanities. Don't look at the circumstance. Don't let the way things look dictate to you what I'm going to do. That's what God was trying to get through this way. And that was a just simple childlike faith. Amen. Praise God. So if you want to go from rag to riches, you want your circumstances turned completely around, and how many want to do better than 2012? Better go up a step higher because everybody's saying, I don't know what's going to happen in 2012, but that 2020 is simply pointing for every time you hear a prophecy, everybody is talking about December the what? 21st, 2012. How many still hearing about that? Amen. So we don't know, you know, I don't believe Jesus is going to come. I don't believe that's going to be the beginning of the tribulation period. But who knows what could happen? Catastrophic could happen. It won't take too much to turn this world in a total mess. Amen. Just like Iran, suppose a conflict with Iran. Amen. It's precipitated. And that would be what? That would be serious, right? Suppose Israel try to bomb Iran, or Iran try to bomb Israel. We know that would be the beginning of what? Beginning of the very last. Okay, man. So don't say nothing is going to happen because we don't know. You know what could happen. It's not this Japan thing, and all of these EU nations, they are having some real financial what challenges, right? Amen. And all of these nations are going, some of them are going broke. One little thing happened, it could impact what? Every nation. I mean, we could all be what severely impacted. Okay. Anybody have anything to say? This woman, to me, she was nobody that had a whole lot of credentials behind her name. But one thing about it, she had a good heart. She listened, she was able to hear the voice of God. Amen. And down in her heart, she had a desire of what? To do the thing that will please God and bring deliverance to her and her household. Because she just took God at his word, submitted to God. Well, that's a huge quality. That's a huge virtue. The ability to hear the voice of God. How many know that? A lot of times we hear, but we don't hear. We hear with our what? Natural ears. But we don't hear it with our what? Spiritual ears. Anybody understand what I'm saying? We hear it with our what? Natural ears, and we go out of here, amen, or wherever we hear it, and we just like we haven't what? We haven't heard nothing. How many of you got spiritual ears back in here somewhere?
Amen.
Down in here somewhere. Maybe they down in here just spiritual. All right. But that brought her, gave her a miracle on a consistent basis for a whole year. Cruise of oil didn't fail. I mean, the meal barrel didn't run dry. Started out with a cup. God filled the whole thing up. Every time it went down a little bit, it popped right back up. Amen. So that's what we get for what? Hearing the voice of God and responding to his word and doing what he said. You know, childlike faith. That's all we need is what? Childlike faith. Amen. How do you explain to a person, you're just trying to explain to a person that God is still a healer, God can heal you of whatever malady you have without any what medicine, without any doctors, without any medical assistance, without any surgery. God still can heal like that. How many believe that God can still heal like he did in Bible days?
Amen.
Amen. Bible minds, it's kind of hard for us to what? See it, because you say, how? I've had this for 25 years, and how this is going to go away without the doctor or anything happening, just trusting God. Amen. You know, a child, you know, you talk to him a little bit, he wouldn't have to tell you, he wouldn't have to say, well, are you sure this is going to go away? How can you explain to me what's going to hide the process of the healing, how it's going to take place? Suppose it don't happen, though. What do I do? You know, you don't have to go through all of those explanations trying to explain things to a child. If you promise a child tomorrow, I'm going to bring you, buy you a pair of tennis, how many questions does he ask you? He said, are you sure you got the money? If you spend the money, how are you going to get it back? Now, how much money do you have? You know, child's just going to what? Take you at your what? Take you at your word. Amen. Tomorrow evening, amen, you better make sure that you promised it, that I have it. You're going to try to get it from somewhere. Amen. But we as adults, we just went, I don't believe you can come up with that kind of money. We have 1,000 questions. Analyze it, psychoanalyze it. But a child is just what? It's simple. They just take you at your word. So that's kind of faith that we have to. I don't know. I guess we have to find a way to get out of flesh, so that our five senses don't run the show. Those five senses, boy, they're always going to say, no, you ain't got it, it ain't going to happen. Don't get your hopes built up, because it might not happen. We'll see. But childlike faith would just take the Lord at his word. And I think that was a virtue. Amen. That's a virtue that all of us should what really desire. Amen. Just submit to God. Lord, if you say it, I believe it, so be it unto me. So be it. Amen. So that might be some work that we have to do to get to that point. That's the point that God wants us to get. All right, let's look at the 2 Kings 5. Now Naaman, captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He was also a mighty man in battle, but he was a leper. Now, he did have his problems when he was told by the prophet to go and dip 7 times and his flesh would become clean. He had a problem with the place that the prophet told him to go and dip, because that was the dirtiest and nastiest river around, but there was a whole lot of clean rivers, at least two that he could have gone to and what, still dip, and he would have gotten dirty, or he would have been exposed to filthy water. But the prophet told him to go to that particular one river and dip. If he wouldn't do it, he would come up the seventh time. All right, so he objected because his senses or his flesh or his pride said, you know, I don't mind going to the clean river and dip. I ain't going down to this dirty water. I ain't going down. So, but his servants had to what? Appeal to him and what? And really get him to think properly so that he could place himself in a position to get his healing. Amen. And after his servant convinced him, he said, Master, if the king had told you to do some big and mighty thing, you would have done that. But why is it that you don't want to do this, the small thing? All he told you to do, just go and dip in this particular river. That's not a big thing. You can do that. Amen. But that was his pride. Okay, but he overcame that. But what I was going to show you that usually people that God really were able to use, many of them had flaws, but basically they had developed certain qualities that were very useful, very powerful, that God could work through, and that God could actually get his blessings to them if they could overcome, you know, the obstacles that they, the natural, you know, the sense knowledge aspect of it. Okay, so you can see he was a great man with his master. Amen. So the Bible does speak about people that's faithful, people that's committed, people that submit to their leaders and their that's placed over them. So you can see that God just doesn't pour his blessings out on people that don't have no kind of values or no kind of standards or undisciplined, and people that's not going to do anything with the blessing that God is going to release into their life. Usually these people have developed certain disciplines, certain qualities and skills, certain virtues that place them in a position where God could really work through them and really get his blessings through to them. So this man was he was a great man with his master. That meant that what he respected him, he honored him, right? He submitted to him, and he did everything that he could do to please him. And he said, and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto what? Syria. Amen. So God had used this man before because he was an honorable man. He was a mighty man. He was a person that listened to God, submitted to God, or his master. Amen. And he had brought great deliverance for Syria. In other words, he was a man that wanted to be used to get his own country released from the hand of their oppressors. So he was a man of mercy. So he had some very good qualities there that God could work through. And if he could submit those qualities and those virtues to God, and sometimes God has to, by various means, he has to work through us. But many times he has to overcome a lot of unbelief, or sometimes we have certain hindrances working in our lives that prevent God from doing things, but God has a way of getting around those things and pulling from those virtues and those powerful components that he has that has been established or developed in our lives. So I like this about him. Great deliverance into Syria. He also was a mighty man and valor, but he was a what? He was a leper. Amen. So God used this man here to bring deliverance to Syria. And this was the man that God could use to work this mighty miracle. We don't know how many thousands and millions of people were impacted by this one miracle. But he did get his miracle when he obeyed the voice of God. Amen. Seemed like that the servant overruled his objection, and he went on and dipped seven times, and he got his what? Deliverance. But look at those virtues that were already in place in his life. So if you really want to seek God's best in 2012, let's begin to look at the virtues that we must seek to operate in so that it will make it possible for God to get all of these blessings to us. He's just not going to pour his blessing out on just a lot of junk stuff. People that, you know, that know the way and won't do it, you know, that's not being honorable. Is that right? That's not being submissive. That's not being obedient. That's not being faith. The Bible said faith works by what? Love. Right? Faith works by love. That's not being merciful. That's not being good. So when we, you know, many times we get disappointed and we at a loss why God can't do certain things to us, but we have to look at, amen, God can't work through us unless he has the, what, components operating in us. You know, it's got to be faith, it's got to be integrity, it's got to be what, submission, obedience. These are the virtues that God is looking for. He's just not going to arbitrarily pour out his blessings and, you know, and make you rich overnight. If you are not, what, doing, I mean, the smallest thing, and as I was saying last week, is that the thing that many times people don't understand, if our hearts and our wills, if we are not really going in the same direction, or will, or if our purpose is not God's purpose, our will is not united with his will, then the results that we are expected are just what impossible. But this is something that many times we in this age, we are woefully blind of. We can't understand why we can't be blessed regardless of how we, what, uphold the word of God. I mean, live by the word and submit to the word and, you know, and be doers of the word. So we have to keep that in mind. Amen. When we expect God's best, God expects us to, amen, operate in those, what, laws, in the word. See, if God will just bless you regardless of you taking any responsibility, what kind of God would it be? I mean, who could respect a God like that if he could bless us regardless of whether we took him serious, whether we obeyed, whether we walked according to his word, whether we submitted to him, whether we loved him, whether we were people that were merciful, people that were, you know, going out and ministering and helping and blessing people. And the Bible says because God laid down his life for us, Jesus laid down his life for us, we ought to be willing to lay down our lives for our boy, for our brother. We see our brothers in need. Close up our bowels of compassion, how to dwell in the love of God. See, faith works by what? Love. And I would say that, he was cooking to me yesterday, I said that Sister Hill, my wife and I were talking, she said the fastest way for people to be successful now, she said, is that you're going to have to be a person that will be concerned about helping others. You're going to have to really sow in people's lives and do things that will enrich them. And whatever you sow out, the Bible says, blessed are the what? Merciful, for they shall what? Amen. Amen. Give and it shall be what? Given unto you what? Good measure, what? Pressed down, what? Shaken together, and what? Running over, shall God cause men to what? Give unto your bosom. Amen. And the first step, the first thing probably when we first got saved, that God really got through to us, well, he should have got through to us, was that learn how to take God at his word and do what he says do. Probably the first real test of our stewardship probably would be with our money. That's hard to say. And sometimes preachers just don't mess with it because it just makes so many folk mad. Amen. The way that God has designed for us to learn the fear of God. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of God. The fear of God. A wholesome dread of what? Displeasing God. Amen. We have to learn how to what? Take God and His word. If God says that to bring all of the what? Tithe. Right? Nobody gonna help me preach now. Bring all of the what? Tithe into the what? Storehouse. So that will be what? Need in my, in other words, money to pay all of these what bills. You may just like the man ran into that wall. Boy, that took out the insurance money. Got about half of the income, I mean half of it. And you know, we weren't able to pay it. Amen. So how are you going to have meat in the house when you, amen, don't have no walls there?
Yeah.
Amen. It's just a blessing that nobody broke in here and took on all this stuff. All they would have to do is just got through that little makeshift board we had out there. Could have stole all of this stuff here. Our insurance is $10,000. Is that right? Yeah, $10,000 deductible. I'm saying, Pastor, why didn't you just have maybe $2,500? Wouldn't it have been better to have $2,500? That meant that every time the premium is due, you would have to pay what? Probably $1,000 or $1,500 more than the $2,600 you're paying. You $4,000 rather than $2,600. Boy, I could tell you so many stories about God's house. Bible says that there might be what need in God's house. And that's the first lesson. In other words, God said, if you take care of my house, I'll take care of your house. If you take care of my business, then I'll take care of what? How many can take God at His word for that? I mean, you just can't look at it from a natural standpoint. You say, well, I ain't got enough money to pay my bills. Now, who does have enough when you first, you know, there's a point in life, nobody have enough money to take care of everything that's coming after them financially. Very few people, unless somebody like us, old, you're up there 60 and 70, your kids are gone and grown, and you paid your house off and paid off. That's no problem for, you know, people at a certain point in life. But how many are not quite there yet? But you're going to always have what? Obligations and things that's happening that's going to what? Take away every day. And if you're just going to go by what you see, what you feel, we call them lying vanities, because a lying vanity will always tell you you can't do it. See, that's the first lesson that God wants us to know. Trust me for the most important need that you have is your what? Your lavender. Trust me. And how do you trust Him? Amen. Bless you with 100, you give back what? 10 of it. Amen. That should, you know, run you a little short, maybe, you know, because that's where the trust come in, right? Run short, you say, well, God is going to make it up to me some other way. Then you don't stop with the $10. So I'm going to give what? Some for offerings. See, if a person will learn that and be faithful to that and do it, then the scripture says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of what? Wisdom. And it's going to be a transformation. You're going to gradually get what? Established and stable in what you believe. Revelation knowledge. And He's going to what? Rebuke the devourer. He says, give and it shall be given. See, God said that if you give and it shall be given to you, pressed down, shaken together. See, given. Do not start. You can't even obey giving. You can't even give until you have tithe. See, it's not the tithing that God multiplies. Oh, you know, 10, 20, 10, what, 30, 60, whatever, fold. It's the giving part. He said He will multiply. See, the tithing will do certain things. That will cause the what? so many bad things from happening to take away your money. Eat it up. That's what tithing does. And tithing is like the, it's the, that opens the windows of heaven. It opens the windows of heaven. In other words, it opens the windows of opportunity. But what God is able to release through those windows is, amen, depends on what you what give. God is going to pour the blessings. He's going to measure out the blessings in, amen, by the, by the thimble. Everybody know what a thimble is? Cup, a bucket, a load. He's going to multiply those blessings many, many, many times, but it's going to be according to what you're giving. Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to give my tithe, but I'm just going to give as little as I can give. I can just give my tithe. I can just give my tithe. Well, the tithing will do a whole lot. We'll review for some power. I mean, we read Malachi 10, 9. I mean, it will do everything it says do. But the giving doesn't start until the tithing is what? Which is not yours. Tithing does not belong to us, right? Tithing does not what? Belong to us. When we take tithing money and take tithing money and apply it to our own personal bills and needs, the Bible calls that what's that word? Romans 2. When you take what belongs to God and use it for your own personal need, the Bible calls it. Sacrilege, right? Take what is dedicated to the Lord and apply it to your own personal needs. That's what the Bible calls that sacrilege. It's just like, why did, Brother William, y'all studied this in Sunday school, why did he took that Babylonian garment and some, what, silver or gold, whatever, what was that? That was retrieved from the battle that they had with their opposing army.
Yeah.
And he took that for his personal what benefit, and he what? Hid it. Hid it under the tent, right? See, that was supposed to be offered to God. And he went, took it, and hid it. He said, I'm going to have a need. I'm going to come back and get this. So what happened to it? He brought a curse on the whole nation. Nobody would prosper. I mean, they went down in defeat, right? And they had to find out who in the camp had what? Done such an abominable thing. Offered something that's supposed to have been what? Offered to God, and you what? Took it, stole it, hid it. Amen. Planning on using it on your own personal what? Your own personal gain. Amen. So that's what we call sacrilege. Take what should be offered to God and use it for your own personal. That's found in Romans 2. Okay, do you commit sacrilege? The believer, many times we teach people things that we don't do. I mean, we try to teach the world stuff, people that's not saved, but sometimes when one finger is pointing to somebody else, how many is pointing back at you? All right, 4. Four sports back in you. All right, so that's a good little lesson. But we're speaking about integrity. There are certain virtues, boy, that we just got to get our handle on. We just can't be so careless and just ignore things that God plainly says. Amen. You don't have to be no Superman, super duper person. You don't have to be a flying Super Sally or Holy Joe to understand that God wants to teach you the fear of the Lord. God wants to teach all of us what? The fear of the Lord. And the only way that he can teach it, we just have to what? Take him at his word. Whatever he tells us to do, what? Do it. And he starts out real simple. He said, just give, they cost money is the closest thing to your heart. because they represent the sum total of everything you all about. Your wisdom, your knowledge, your skill, amen, and all of the stuff that you have learned that enable you to make money. So all I will ask you for is just what? One dime out of a dollar plus offering. All right. He said, if you do that, then I can teach you the fear of the Lord. I can teach you, amen, that it is a wholesome dread of displeasing God. If you do that, then, amen, then you can begin to, the Bible says that will